Hello and welcome. I'm Pearl Chaozon Bauer, one of the co-founders and organizers of Undisciplining the Victorian Classroom. And as one of the form of content that we're generating for this site, these Zoomcasts are meant to be a mechanism that allows us to stage conversations, to think together about our classroom practices, about our processes of learning and unlearning as teachers, how we can grow together as a community of scholars and learn from one another, especially in moving beyond the boundaries of our field and training. And so this is the second of in a cluster of Zoomcasts on positionality, as scholars initially trained in a national literature that's been integral to producing fantasies of white British superiority, and more importantly, why we advocate to undiscipline Victorian studies as a way to inspire new modes of anti-racist teaching in our classroom spaces. Please note that these reflections come from our personal experiences. We don't intend to speak on behalf of others and are sharing from the position of our own identities, bodies, institutional locations, and backgrounds as a way to spark thought and discussion. Today, I'm joined by Zarena Aslami, Associate Professor of 19th Century British Literature and Culture at Michigan State University, to discuss her academic journey, the collaborative nature of her second book project, and her reflections on how to teach Victorian studies as an undisciplining practice. So welcome, Zarena. Thank you so much for being part of this UVC Zoomcast project. We appreciate your assistance.
Thank you so much, Pearl. Thank you to you and Brian and Sophia and Adrian. I think the project is so awesome and it's very exciting to be invited to do this.
Oh, thank you for being here today. And so we can just start with your journey, you know, from grad student to your job and then teaching maybe the students at Michigan State.
Sure. I think, you know, this is a question that I've had before, and I think I always sort of mess it up. And now I've just decided it's overdetermined how it is that I, you know, became a Victorianist and how my thinking about it has shifted from the first book to the second book. And so I think, you know, when I, you know, for me, and thinking about the journey of becoming a Victorianist, I think it really, a lot of it has to do with reading Victorian novels, like for a lot of us. And I think finding them to be both very, you know, inclusive and exclusive at the same time. And I speak as someone who, you know, is in between cultures, you know, not only like a family within a larger culture, but actually within that family, right? So as I, you know, half white, half Afghan, reading something like Dickens or Eliot, I think that I could feel sort of fascinated by, you know, the proximity to this white world that I could also somewhat identify with, but not identify with. And of course you have the time distance and the spatial difference as well. But I think there was something kind of fascinating about being able to read about that whiteness. But of course those novels are also, the ones that I loved at least, also have so much to do with like the poor and women and like underdogs, like kind of Victorian underdogs too, right, to some degree. So, you know, it's a kind of confusing, you know, again, it's sort of, there's a lot of things that drew me to it while also sort of being positioned outside of it and finding it somewhat exotic, right? Somehow different from me. I think too, the language could be both very inclusive in the sense that with Dickens, you really feel like you're in on the joke with him. Or Eliot makes you feel like you're her intellectual equal when you're reading it. So again, I think that I just had a lot of, ambivalent feelings about those texts, but that they really drew me in. And then when I went to graduate school, I really did want to specialize in the 19th century in part because of that fascination with Victorian novels, but also because the what I'd been learning about history and the kind of Anglo-Afghan contact in the 19th century, helping me sort of explain something again as personal as my dad's British accent, you know, growing up in Kabul, going to a British high school in the 30s or 40s, I guess, the kind of, you know, British imperialism, the way that it existed at that point. So, but the first book, as we were talking about before, really didn't deal with Afghanistan, except one chapter that I wrote as an assistant professor. But in the dissertation, again, I felt like I wanted to write about Thomas Hardy. I wanted to write about political fantasy. That felt really important to me. And I felt like I wanted to be able to do that and not be judged for doing it. And perhaps, again, I think we talked about this before, a kind of reverse orientalism, the kind of fascination with white culture, but not really calling it out as such. So it's only later that I think in this moment, after just years and years of teaching and researching and thinking and living in the US, I think has made it feel much more urgent to me to think much more about how whiteness is functioning, how it's being centered. And I will say that there's a long history of that in our field in Victorian studies too. That people, especially since the 90s, I think, especially those moments when Victorian studies and postcolonial studies came together,
right,
where there's a lot of possibility. And then sometimes there's like amnesia around that, or it gets dropped, or people don't read it, you know, maybe their grad student training doesn't take them to that. And that's a question we should be asking too. Like, why aren't we doing more of that work and building on it, developing it so that it is more relevant to the present even? Because, you know, even from the 90s to now, I think there's continuity, but there's also new historical circumstances that, right, that I think we can address.
Right. I was so curious about that sort of that liminal position that you were talking about, just the outsider insider. Is that something that you were always aware of even as a child, or was that something that you're able to theorize now as an adult looking back? I'm reading a great expectation, so that's on my mind right now.
Yeah, totally. No, I think I was very aware, because it was like, you know, I lived that experience very much in my household of, having, you know, the kind of white American side of the family and then a brown African side of the family, and feeling both, identifying with both and disidentifying with both.
Right.
From the beginning, I felt that very strongly. And I do think that in part did, you know, there's aspects of that experience that did draw me to Victorian literature, because there is a sense of, you know, even with Dickens, as white as he is and as bad as he was to his wife, you know, a sense of being on the inside and the outside. You know, his own experience, you know, with an imprisoned father. And
exactly, right.
I think that those novels can actually pick up on something that that we can, you know, develop further or identify with, but also critique.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I was also drawn to your comment about grad school and just maybe not being prepared for this kind of thought. And I find that really it depends on the professors in your program at the time you're in the program, right? Because our faculty are teaching their expertise.
Yeah.
And so it does feel like there isn't enough maybe being done nationally to try to make those stances, although maybe that's changing
in
the current times.
Yeah, I would hope so. I mean, I do think we're struggling. I mean, just on the practical level, you know, our program, grad program, is getting smaller, which means we offer fewer grad seminars.
Right.
Because to get them to even fill is going to be an issue. And so in terms of the number of 19th century British courses we offer, we're going to maybe offer one every other year. So then, you know, we do independent studies and we figure out ways to address that. But I do think that can be an issue with the grad education. And so it's great to see so many wonderful grad students at MLA and NAFSA. And really, and especially with COVID, showing up for Zoom talks where it's more affordable to do that, to pursue the things that are interesting them. And, you know, I think a lot of faculty, you know, want to help their grad students and are leading them in those directions, even if they can't do it formally in a course. But
has your department started talking about these kinds of, you know, issues, concerns, and maybe shifting the grad program? And
yeah, absolutely. So, colleagues like Yomara Figueroa and then my current chair, Justice Nealand, they worked very hard to develop a program that we call MUSE, which is Mentoring Underrepresented Scholars in English.
Oh, nice.
But we suspended it during COVID, but ran it the previous 2 years, where we brought, you know, really talented scholars who are from underrepresented groups and, you know, had them sit. We invited them to campus and got them in our grad seminars. And then we met with them to help them with their application materials. So it was very much a recruitment technique.
Wow.
Yeah, we can apply here too. Look how great we are. You know, some mentoring that we're going to offer. And so we have really made that commitment to really trying to diversify our grad student body in the hopes of, you know, contributing to a more diversified professoriate across fields.
Yeah. And actually that leads us to the next question, because there is this collaboration happening there, right? Bringing in people who have other expertise or, you know, positionalities that we may not have to support everyone, right?
I've learned so much from my colleagues across fields. It's amazing what you learn, like from your Victorianist colleagues, but then what you learn from your department colleagues, because there might just be one Victorianist in your department. I haven't
right.
But there are three, actually. I have two colleagues.
Wow.
To have, you know, to be in discussion with other colleagues. So again, my colleague, Yomara Figueroa, had the idea of starting, you know, requiring a course on that really thinks about race at the grad level.
Yeah, so, very good.
That's going to start next year. So it'll be a requirement. In addition to pre-1800, grad students will take a race, gender, and the human course that really gets them to think about, you know, no matter what you're studying it in the US in an institution of higher ed that has a particular kind of history.
Exactly.
And so it really, you know, it takes very strongly from ethnic studies, I think, and critical race theory to think
right.
of institutional conditions of producing knowledge.
Yes, exactly. So
that by making them really aware and talking and reading, that no matter what they end up specializing in, they'll take that knowledge with them.
Oh, that's fantastic. I love that. And I think that I'm sure, or I hope anyway, that these moves are happening elsewhere at yeah. other programs, yeah. other universities. Yeah. It seems like it. It seems like there's a lot of talk right now. I mean, my fear is that this is the flavor of the month and, you know, it's going to be forgotten, but maybe not. And I think if more people like us are continuing to move this kind of thinking and project forward, it won't be forgotten.
I agree. And I do think it's the idea of collaboration is so critical to that. Like the idea of collaborating with your colleagues outside your field, but also the kind of collaborations that's happening among faculty, grad students, and undergrads, because it's the undergrads and the grad students and the fact they all want the same thing.
Yes, exactly.
They work together to get the university to do it, you know?
So yes.
great intergenerational and different.
Yes.
Because I do feel like it's very responsive to students, but I also think the students, you know that it's not all students, it's some students. But that everybody can, you know, will benefit from this. Everybody will benefit from that kind of education.
Right. Speaking of students, have you had your teaching shifted when you started teaching at Michigan State? What's your demographics? And
yeah, you know, I think, you know, where it's interesting because at Michigan State, I would say it felt a lot whiter than where I'd been before, but it also felt like that the students seemed much more aware of kind of class politics than where I'd been before. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it's Michigan. We have a lot of students coming from rural Michigan, a lot of students who are first generation. And I think that they had, like, they were really attuned to labor issues in a way.
That makes sense to me, actually.
Yeah. So teaching marks would be like, well, of course, you know, like there'd be a lot
yeah.
of, you know, that would go over really well. Sometimes talking about race wouldn't, because there was a sense of like, well, we're Michigan, racism
right.
South.
Right.
You know, and I think, but that I think has been less true since I started there in the early 2000s. I think that our student campus is very aware of racism and has been very active in making demands of the university and of the community. So that I think has shifted in the, gosh, the long time that I've been there.
Oh, that's great though. And I love that student agency and yeah. that the administration's listening.
Yes, I right? think they really are. I mean, they have to.
They have to. Yeah, exactly. And I hope that this is a shift that happens just really, again, nationally, globally, in higher ed.
Yeah. And by formalizing it, that's kind of our hope too. Like by making this a required course, making it part of the curriculum, you know, we want it to live on with our students.
Yeah, perfect. Well, so kind of changing our, you know, direction a little bit. Let's talk about your second project, because your first book project and your second project were very different in terms of the collaboration that occurred in the second book, right?
Oh, right, absolutely. So a question. So the second book is, you know, in some ways the reason I went into grad school, although, you know, I still think the first book was an important part of like my development and something that I wanted to do. And I still really like that book. But the second book looks at basically Victorian representations of Afghanistan. And it emerges again out of my, you know, interest in my heritage. And just thinking about how obscure Afghanistan was, even when I was growing up until 9/11.
Yeah.
I had never talked about it. Even with the Soviet invasion and Cold War stuff, it was really not, and then it was just in the news everywhere. It continues to be, right? It hasn't, it's like in the news. I feel like I see it in the paper all the time.
Yeah, so, for sure.
But it struck me that especially the way in which it wasn't mentioned is also present in, say, Victorian studies, as well as in post-colonial studies, that even though the British fought two wars there in the 19th century, it's barely mentioned in Victorian studies or histories of British Empire. Mm-hmm. Post-colonial studies really only seems to talk about Afghanistan post 9/11, but not the kind of two imperial wars in the 19th century. Because it wasn't colonized, right?
Afghanistan
wasn't colonized, but it was invaded, it was occupied, and then the British kind of shaped the foreign policy, like with collaboration from the emir. But you know how much choice they had in the matter is another. But yes, the British were invested in keeping Afghan sovereign and not like a colonized site, but they really did want to control it. And there's all kinds of failure around that, failure that continues into the present. But a question I would get, and I just thought, you know, at first I thought it's enough of an intervention in Victorian studies and histories of British Empire and post-colonial studies to just talk about Afghanistan and to pull together an archive of Victorian representations of Afghanistan. But I kept getting the question from the very beginning, what about Afghan voices? Where are those texts in your archive?
Yeah,
and I had to finally agree that was a really important question, and that and also I think I thought at the time, well, I don't speak Farsi or Pashto, and so I don't have to, but I can't. But as you know, I think I did, like I mentioned to you, I talked with Ryan about this at one point. We can hire translators, and so I'm working with a translator now who's based in Kabul, and so she's going to help me with a war poem written after the first Anglo-Afghan war that circulated, because I'm really curious to see how the first Anglo-Afghan war, became part of like an epic poetry in the Afghan.
Yeah, right.
And so I think that'll, so that's going to be exciting. And so this is a project I can't do on my own. And I didn't want to just not do it, not include the Afghan voices, nor did I just not want to do the project. But I think, we can hire translators and we can collaborate with other people. And so that's a really exciting part of this process, which is really different from the first book.
That's wonderful. Have you learned anything about yourself? Maybe just in terms of the researching the history or even working with an Afghan speaker, Farsi?
It's funny. It's a great question. I have loved connecting with scholars of Afghanistan, whether they are American or Afghan themselves. And I have been able to reach out and get in touch with various Afghan scholars. And they've all been just so supportive, I think, it doesn't feel like there's any competition in this field.
It's so nice.
What you're doing is great. And people need to learn about Afghanistan. Thank you for doing this. This is awesome. Here's more resources. Here's something you can talk to. That I have loved. So I've loved feeling like I'm part of a community that's different from, say, just my family community, but like actual Afghan scholars. Mm. So in terms of what I've learned about, I have thought about like wanting to do more research of my family. Mm. And maybe that would be a future project. There's challenges just with finding archival materials in Afghanistan where I can't travel. Just, what does it mean to, in a war-torn country, where does that stuff
go?
But it is something that I would like to, it's part, I feel like I'm learning about myself when I'm doing this work.
That's amazing.
Part of me,
Yeah. And maybe that third project can be a little different, right? I mean, like those questions could be the central questions, right? So maybe the answers won't matter as much, but the process will matter, right?
Yeah, I think that's true.
Like part memoir, part research, part, I don't know.
Yeah, no, I think totally. I think they're very impossible to separate.
Yeah.
Those kinds of questions as we're doing any kind of project.
Right, yeah.
Even if it's not based on your identity necessarily, but any, I think it's there, we bring ourselves into it.
So. Right, exactly. I mean, I'm sure, you brought yourself into any of the work that you're writing on Hardy or, Dickens or whatever, right?
Thomas Hardy's so depressing and awesome.
I know, I love him so much. He's so depressing though.
It's great.
Well, we talked about our third question being around teaching, right? Mm-hmm. So our big project or our big focus in UVC is thinking about anti-racist pedagogy in the classroom. Yeah. So what are your thoughts on that? How have you, you know, incorporated that in your own classes or potentially, you know, maybe dream classes that you haven't yet taught but are now thinking about because of what's the shifts that are happening?
Yeah, no, I think I am learning so much from you and the website. I don't feel like an expert at all in anti-racist pedagogy. I'm really trying to unlearn a lot of things and learn new things. And I am afraid of making mistakes, and I know I will. But I've started to think more, and you know, it's as many people other than me have said, it's not even just about including voices of color in the classroom in terms of what you're reading, but it's about how you're reading things.
Yes, exactly.
So you know, to people who say, "Oh my God, we're never going to teach Dickens again," I would say, "No, absolutely." Like, I love Dickens, and I will totally teach Dickens, but I will also we will also read things that expose the limits of Dickens,
right,
and kind of habits of racism that on which that the authority of the novel grounds itself.
You know, right,
we have
exactly
to do that too, and it's going to be uncomfortable. I want to think about that. I want to think more. You know, I collaborated with two colleagues, Andrea Tange and Mary Catherine Harrison. We came up with a course on Victorian race, and this we taught it, I think, in 2017 in our different institutes, our different locations. And, you know, the course was really coming out of like, you know, the 19th century is a place where race really gets formalized, race science appears, race really shifts from how we think about it in the 18th century to the end of the 19th, let's do a whole course around it. And I learned a lot, all my students were white, and I wonder if, how the class would have been different if it had been mixed. And I think about that a lot because some of the stuff was really racist and uncomfortable, and how that would have made certain students feel in that space. So I have more thinking to do, and I think more collaborating with others to get better ideas about how to teach certain kinds of material, but also how to engage students around it. But one of the things I really liked about that assignment was it was again collaborative, because yeah, what all the students in the different classes had to do was annotate an out of print text by a person of color. So we had, I was gonna look it up before I talked to you.
It's okay.
I'm blanking on it. Anyway, South Asian traveler, Voyage to England, I think is what it's called. Blanking on it. Out of print, Hotta Trust had it scanned. And so then we used Hypothesis, the annotation tool. So all students were annotating pages. And then we came up with the final edition, which was, we wanted them to think of it as a broad view edition.
Yeah.
So we annotated, and then each class among the students, they worked in groups to come up with the topics for an appendix at the end, where they had to find primary documents to explore an aspect, whether it was like a religion or you know, women's issues at the time, colonial law, like, you know, so they really had to do that. And it was great to see students across at three institutions work on that text together and, you know, and think about what this Indian traveler to England's experience was like, and to really unpack that as well. And then their final project was to write the critical introduction to what this whole package was. That was a kind of individual project. So that I love. I love how that project worked out. As I look toward, you know, as I think about things that aren't even Victorian, you know, I think for me, I've just started to really foreground questions or critical questions around race right at the beginning of the class. So that even as we turn to gender and sexuality, we're thinking about race, because I think about how I've taught like an intro to literary theory course in the past, and you follow the sequence of the literary theory anthology, you're typically going to get feminism first, then queer theory, right, then it's going to be race and post-colonial theory. And so I flipped that the last time I taught that class. So we started with race and post-colonialism. And so then as we moved to early feminism, early queer theory, the students were like, well, this presumes whiteness.
Right, exactly.
Talk about blackness with
yes,
this.
Yes, yes.
Like, wow, like you just did all my work for me.
Yeah.
I think that I really will hold on to that. you know, not that the goal is to bash feminism or queer theory, but also like that's really important.
Absolutely. I mean, these are sort of the structural inequities that we're missing, let's say, for feminism, like first and second wave, right? So it's so great that students are already seeing that because they had the background. So
yeah, so let's start with these big, these questions and then move and then see what's the value of this text, where what its limits are, you know, yeah. And how we push it to get to that. So, but I, you know, and I also think, you know, innovations and transformative teaching, I think I'm really going to be trying to learn more about like how to, you know, have a contract at the beginning of the, yeah. of the class where we talk about all kinds of things, including the use of the N word and all, you know, there's
yes.
all kinds of things that as we, I just think we're gaining a lot more understanding of how to teach in a way that is not going to be harmful to our students.
Yeah.
But it involves having that conversation in a contract at the beginning of the class that students are participating in actively too. And so I have colleagues who are way better at that than me. So that's what I mean by collaboration. I intend to, you know, get their help and just ask for their advice too. But those are the things that are important to me as I think about returning to the classroom.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is the key. It's just asking ourselves these questions and saying, you know, what are my strengths? Where do I need to learn? Yeah. And who can I go to for help? And then other people doing that will, you know, obviously will come to us too, right? And so it's just this web of helping each other. That's really, I think, at the heart of undisciplining, I think.
Yeah, yeah, and not making claims toward expertise.
Yes, exactly, right.
I don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
I know, and I know who to ask.
Exactly, yeah. And then I think importantly, working with the students is key. I mean, that's the agency, but also just making them active participants in their learning and the importance of classroom culture that really comes from the class and not just from top-down model, right?
I mean, it sounds like you yourself have got a lot of experience in transformative teaching.
Yeah.
And those principles. So I'll probably be hitting you up. Later.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I learned from other people too. I mean, for me, it was all about a collaboration, just working at an institution that's HSI and ANAPESI and having to really rethink my pedagogy because I wasn't trained to do any of this in the grad school level, you know?
Right. I mean, that's an incredible amount to learn on the job. Mm-hmm. And have that become your job.
Yes, exactly.
How to teach.
Yeah. We're almost out of time, but I was so curious to hear about, you know, how you co-taught or you taught a class that had the same syllabus, but in three different institutions. Mm-hmm. What were the experiences of your other two collaborators?
I think so. One was at McAllister, and then one was at University of Detroit Mercy, and then I was at NYU. And so we initially had wanted our students to Zoom together and to the three classrooms to like have moments where we would come together and talk about the texts. And I think that, you know, I think it was difficult for the students at University of Detroit Mercy, many of whom work like almost full time, more complicated schedules. A lot of my students also had that problem.
Yeah.
We found that that some libraries had more access to resources than others.
Yeah.
You know, so I think some of the just differences, like structural differences, came out. And then I think the students were a little maybe shy about talking to each other about, particularly, you know, thinking about how race is being constructed. And, you know, so that's something else that I want to think more about, to empower students to analyze the thing that makes them uncomfortable, but yeah. to also be mindful not to be harmful to others.
Right. You know, yeah.
There.
Yeah.
So that was interesting because we were at very different institutions.
Which is also an interesting conversation, right? Like, why are some institutions more funded in terms of library and support than others? And, you know, you look at the kinds of student populations that you have and just make that part of the conversation, which is exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I think that there was a lot. I think we learned a lot from that whole experience. And the final product with everyone's input was really fantastic.
I know. I was imagining an addition, like you reaching out to MLA or something like that and putting together all those annotations because the work is there. So how cool would that be? Well, I think we are out of time. Last thoughts or comments to our UBC viewers?
No, I think the work of UBC is fantastic and it's going to be a great resource for me. And, you know, I'm honored to be, you know, for my thoughts to be asked and to be in conversation with you. I don't know. I think there's exciting work going at all levels So I'm hopeful for our field.
Me too. I'm hopeful for our field and for higher ed in general, and then appreciating the kinds of collaborations that people like you are bringing to our DH project. So thank you so much for your time and for your thoughts. I'm sure the viewers will appreciate everything that you said.
Well, I look forward to collaborating with them as well someday.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pearl.